Shen made a perfect presentation on Yuri, and I'll just make a short reference to our long-time friendship. I'm not going to touch much of his scientific development. We have been friends for a long time. Friends don't talk about science much unless they go to the lab, and that's what we did. First time I met him in 1972, when we were attending the St. Petersburg conference, and this incredible man was very tough on the scientific, in his scientific attitude to whatever you report. And it was interesting to see him kind of in a half dream sitting in a chair, and all of a sudden they splash. What did you say? Can you repeat this again? So you were quite happy that he doesn't listen all these details that you are developing, and all of a sudden here he is with his tough question, and that's how he was. Whether he's friend or not, he is very tough when it comes to the science. What I wanted to do, I wanted to touch things that not very much known, because there are a lot of gossips and rumors about inspiration that he got from different sources, where it came from, how he conceived this idea. If, say, we know pretty well from Emmett how he moved gradually from SAR to holography, it was not absolutely clear with Denisuk, because he was not in a SAR, he was in a space-related program, very military and secure program with State Optical Institute, but definitely not SAR. In a book that he wrote, there is a reference to Lucretius on a wavefront formation. And if you read that carefully, you will see that words that he kind of used for better understanding how the object is reproduced by the wavefront. And the wavefront is basically the copy. It's unbelievable that was written in the first century BC. And Denisuk grabbed that piece. Fortunately, at that time, we still had education in Latin. And probably that inspired him to some extent. Although he mentioned in a book, in another article, in My Life in Holography, that a well-known fiction writer, Ivan Efremov, and you can see him here, gave him some insights on holography too. And read this carefully, and you will see that. From this paragraph, you see this pre-holography explanation. Bear in mind, it was written in 1944, even before Gabor. Although Gabor was absolutely unknown in the Soviet school until late 60s, 65, 66. The field of holography was really unknown. Denisuk was working in an obscure field, and that is why he was so badly criticized, because people, and specifically in the Optical Institute, it seems to be logical and reasonable that people will believe in that particular institute that something new he created. No, no way. They actually wanted to explore and see if this man is mentally healthy. You can imagine the pressure he used to work. There were different issues in that aspect. Nature of the country, his father-in-law who was a Jewish man, all that just really fell on him in a very heavy pressure. In addition to that, much later, when already he was well recognized, in one of his papers, he mentioned Lenin, unforgivable in the Soviet academic regime. With all that Soviet pressure, Lenin was not very well respected by academicians, fortunately. But they couldn't forgive him that. When I talked to him, we met many times, and we actually spent a long time in Bogota, in Colombia, working together on several projects. And I asked him, why did you do that with Lenin? What was the reason? You're not a political figure. You are not a member of the party. Why did you need to do so? And he said, believe it or not, as a good student, and everybody had to do that, I read Lenin's papers. And one of them really came back to me with this idea. So it's a combination. You don't say it came from Lucretius, it came from Efremov, or from Lenin. It's a combination of effects, strangely enough. I'd like to come back a little bit and see his vision, where he came from, because he was really upset when people call it Lippmann holography. Imagine you have a lens between the light and the object. That would be Lippmann. You need to create the image with the Lippmann system. Denisuk's idea is much broader. What he recorded, as he saw it, these layers of the wavefront that he wanted to froze, his explanation would be, let me keep it in a frozen box. freeze the wavefront, bring it to the warm area, and then release it, and this wavefront will run again. No matter which direction you take, this way you will receive it reflection, you will receive it transmission, you will receive it Gabor. So he was much broader, and he fundamentally see it much different. Believe it or not, his vision of holography was so deep that sometimes it was difficult to argue with him, because he would be few steps beyond and above. His understanding was just remarkable, and that is why when you come back to that and you read again this small, that's his portrait, his hologram, you really see that phrase from Yefremov back. And read it carefully and you will see this enormous eyes, this flash of the eyes in the hologram. So that's him, that's his vision and replication of vision of others in the holography that he produced. So he became, the life is different and life is really strange, I believe, due to the strong arguments in United States who really initiated holography or revitalized it, Denisuk became known for us. Holography became extremely popular, and I remember the joke that Winston Koch once said in Novosibirsk, in the Winter School of Holography. We had a slide today from TJ when one lady from Australia, I believe, exotic dancer. In Russian, holography, holo means nude. So we call it nudography, and that is why probably it became so popular. It's a joke, of course, but many labs were. It was easy. Material existed. And one of the mystics remained. This is a conference in Kyiv I made in 1989. If you will look carefully, there is always mystic with Denisuk. Flash. You don't see his face. You don't see his image. And said, don't spoil the film. You will not see me. It's a nature of my secret work. They coded me, he said. That would be him. You will see a lot of familiar faces here. Later on, I learned how to make it. You need to have either a glass of wine nearby or a charming woman. Look at that. It works well. Now you can see him well. TJ, you can...
He's the man.
Yeah, okay. We had a nice time with Denisuk, always discussing. He was the man who would mostly concentrate around holography, around different fields. He was so much excited about that field. He couldn't shift to any other. He would divide holography on sub area, and it would be constantly, whether it's party or not, you would see him talking to people. You would see him talking to Nick, for instance, in this picture, in the upper one, or sitting in a conference chair and still thinking about that. And let me see. You will see the chain of the pictures at different time, it's a rare one when we see Denisuk and Emmett on the same podium. I believe it's a Lake Forest. It's on your porch.
Huxley.
Yeah, it's in your place, yeah. So we really enjoyed having been in touch with him, and he was, for a long time, he was a very good friend, and I enjoyed his friendship. And he remained very optimistic, looking in the future. I had a talk, last time I talked to him, when we learned that Emmett passed away, and we were preparing a special issue of holography in speckled journals. It's still in preparation, and we discussed with him what we will put together, because he would have a hard time to do it by himself. He was not very well, and that's the last time I talked to him. And next things I learned, he got sick, and then we lost him. Thank you very much.